Hello, everyone. I am so glad that you're joining us for Church Online. My name is McKenna, and I'm a youth leader here at Westside. We are so fortunate to be a part of such a wonderful community, so I would like to encourage you to engage with this online community. So before you go full screen, hop on that chat and say hello to somebody. As a part of today's service, we will be receiving practical help from God's Word, finding out about ways to make a difference, and hearing some songs of hope and encouragement. We will also be sharing how you can find the support that you're looking for, no matter what season you are in right now. If you have students or children, stick around till the end to learn more about our on-demand content that will help your family thrive. If you are joining us on Sunday morning, I would like to ask you to text the word CONNECT to 503-905-9067. That will pop up a simple form where you can share a bit about yourself, request more information about Westside opportunities, and programs, and also request prayer. So I would love for everyone joining us today to take 30 seconds to complete that form with as much information as you feel comfortable sharing. You will want to make sure that we have your email address though, because Pastor Gabe sends out weekly emails on ways to connect and to take next steps. If you are with us for the first time, woohoo, I'm super excited. Please let us know, because we have a gift for you. It is a book called Sticky Faith, written by Pastor Gabe. This is just a short book packed full of helpful content on how to move forward in your spiritual journey, no matter where you're starting from. So let us know your first timer. Let us know your email through that connect button, and we will get that sent out to you. All right, I'm sure many of you heard of our drive-in service that happened last month. If you missed it, not to worry, we are doing it again. I'm so excited. I was like wilding out at the last one, honking my horn like crazy. Anyways, it is going to be happening on Sunday, August 23rd at 11:30 a.m. We'll have live music, teaching, and even taking communion together. So if that's something that you want to be a part of, I suggest you sign up for that like today, because there are limited parking spaces and you can do that through that Connect form. All right, calling all neighbors. It is that time of year again. Our annual Good Neighbor Project is happening on August 30th. If you do not know what the Good Neighbor Project is, let me tell you a little bit about it. So we set aside one Sunday every summer to take our services to the streets. So do not hop online on August 30th. We will not be there. We will be serving our community. So we do a bunch of different projects like school cleanup, home maintenance, youth services, veteran services, acts of kindness, and even prayer. I personally am doing the Aloha High School Little Warriors Preschool Project. I have a real heart for children and for the youth. So I'm super excited and fortunate to be able to help out with that project and get their school ready for them to come back after a pretty tough year. So when you go to sign up, because I know all of you guys will be signing up, there is a brochure where you can look at all of the projects and see like a small, you know, kind of a review of what the project is to find out where you best fit. Please let us know your t-shirt size, because we do hit the streets matching. You can do all of that through the Connect button. All right, as many of you know, all of our outreach, our ministry to kids and students, our online services, our groups, events, and even our strategic ministry partnerships around the world are made possible by your faithful and generous giving. So a huge thank you for making Westside the kind of church that keeps reaching out and expanding, serving, planting churches, and making a difference in even a global pandemic. So y'all are heroes. When you give, you make a real difference in real people's lives. So I would love to have you join me in giving today. You can give online by clicking that give button in the chat. You can text WCCA to 77977. You can give on our website, our app. So tons of easy ways that you can do that. You can also consider automating your giving. That's what I do. It makes it super easy speezy for me. It'll make it easy speezy for you. And then it also helps us as a church to plan our future outreach and increase our impact as well. So thank you guys for that. Today we are going to be continuing our series, Where is Jesus in All of This Mess? So I would like to encourage you to engage with this message by clicking on that notes tab and hopping in the chat as we learn together today. Today we're going to be asking the question, where is Jesus in all my confusion? I know I really need this one. I'm sure there's a lot of you that need this one. So let's get started.
a lot is changing. It feels like every time I wake up, my first job of the day is to figure out what the day has changed, but what else has changed today? I feel like there's always things that are changing. And when you think about the people that you know, there's some people that love change and there's some people that hate change. Like if you go to your favorite restaurant and if they told you that your favorite burger, they put a new sauce on your burger, there are some people that would be like, oh, let's try. If it's new, it's got to be better. Let's absolutely try that. But there's some people that start to freak out. They're like, no, do not press the change button. I do not want a new sauce. Leave it alone. Don't touch it. And they don't like change. Those are the type of people that maybe they are considering whether or not they really want to abandon VHS and go to DVD. And if you don't know what VHS is, that's proving my point. They do not like change. But we all respond to change differently. Sometimes I wonder whether or not the change is the actual problem, or is it our personality coming through? Like that new sauce on the burger, is the new sauce actually better, or is it just something new and exciting that we're excited about, or something that we hate? Maybe it's not even the sauce. Maybe it's just our personality. But there, things are changing, and some things are changing fast. Some things aren't changing fast enough. But I know that when there is change, if we don't understand what's going on, it leads to confusion, right? We get confused. We don't know what to do next. And that's why today I want to present to you two simple, powerful principles that I think will help in those times of confusion. Now, there's all kinds of stuff that we are dealing with right now. You know, you think about the racism stuff that's going on in our country, and it's confusing to know how do we respond, or should we respond, or are people responding the right way, or what needs to change and how fast does it need to change? Or when you think even about COVID, how do you respond to COVID? Do you wear a mask? Do you not wear a mask? Do you yell at the person not wearing a mask? Like, what should our response be? No matter where you're watching this, you probably have a government official that is directing the path of your region, and you may agree or disagree with them, but their changes are coming on a regular basis. And how do we respond? Sometimes it's really confusing to know how to respond. Then think about, you know, homeschooling or school this fall. Like, when you think about whether or not you're going to send your kids to school, or are you going to stay home and homeschool them? Are they going to do distance ed? It can be something that almost makes you want to pull your hair out. Like, how am I going to pull this off? I'm confused. I don't know where to go. And in the midst of all that, how many of our families have been in our homes for the last several months, and the dynamics in our families have changed from a year ago? They're different, and we're navigating how to deal with cabin fever in a way that we probably never have dealt with before. Even marriage dynamics change, and they're changing now because of everything that we are dealing with, but they always change. You think about when you go from being a couple to having kids, now that's different, and then having older kids who there's lots of stuff going on to the dynamic that changes when your kids leave home, maybe they come back. Those are all changes that happen that we have to deal with, and sometimes they're really confusing. You think about 2020 and all of the problems. We'll probably never say the phrase hindsight is 2020 ever again, right? Because that is going to have a different connotation to the following generations than it does to us. Like, if I talked about 2020, it probably brings back angst, and we don't want to go there. But that we deal with these changes and this confusion all the time. If we've never met, my name is Steve. I'm the executive pastor here at Westside, and I've been through a number of changes in my life. The first almost more than half of my life, I lived in another country with a different culture. In many ways was the same, but in many ways was different. How the country connected to its citizens and how the citizens connected to each other was different. And then just under half of my life, I moved to the U.S. I actually moved from Alberta to Detroit, Michigan. And let me tell you, that was change. That was confusing. I remember the first time that I figured out that in order to turn left in Michigan, I needed to turn right. that was the weirdest thing in the world. Why in the world did you turn right to turn left? But it's a Michigan left. It was confusing. And then the cultural differences, not only the cultural differences from Canada to the US, but I was going from Alberta to a very diverse part of the country. Not only was I confused about the fact that they called it the Midwest, to me, that there's no West about Michigan, but they call it the Midwest. So I just was confused and went along with it. But the cultural differences, even the cultural differences in white culture and black culture, was there are many times that I was confused and didn't know what to do next. And that was only the beginning of some of the changes that began to happen. I was in ministry when I was in Michigan. And when we left Michigan, we came to Portland. I decided not to go back into ministry. And so I went into the marketplace and I worked in a number of different industries. One of those places I worked was at Netflix. And I don't know if you remember this, but Netflix mails DVDs to you. And while I was working there, I remember the month that we told the public that we were going to spin off our DVD business as something separate. And it did not matter what your job was normally at Netflix. Now it was getting on the phone and talking to customers who were frustrated and confused. It was not a fun time. While that was happening, I was actually attending Westside while here in its Aloha location. And I remember as I started to attend soon after that, we moved from our building here to Aloha High School. And that was something very different. There was a lot of change associated with that. Some of it was new and confusing. And how is this going to work? And then I became a campus pastor at Aloha High School while we went multi-site, while our church became a multi-site church. And that was change. And there were confusing parts about that. What going from being a single site to being a multi-site and how to make decisions and how to operate was change. And there were confusing pieces in that. And then this year, this spring, we went from being a multi-site church to a family of churches, which has had God's fingerprints all over it. I'm so excited about this move forward. But in that midst, we had learned how to do stuff as a multi-site church and now becoming a family of churches. We launched our Tiger campus as Bedrock Community Church and our Tannisbourne campus as Epic Life Church. And the way that we made decisions and how we worked together was changing, and dealing with the confusion and that change was important. I think about my family. When Lori and I first decided to have a family, we went through a lot of miscarriages together, and that was a confusing and painful time trying to understand why in the world this was happening. And then we had two boys, and that was great because I grew up in a house full of boys. I knew how a house full of boys should work, right? I had a great example of how it should work. And so we started to function as a family. And then we decided that we were going to foster and adopt and really parenting with the state. Man, that was confusing. There were so many pieces of that were so confusing. And if you're a parent or if you watched a parent of a family of two, you realize that math works when you're talking about one kid plus one kid equals two kids. But when you add a third kid, it's exponentially larger. It's not like 2 + 1 = 3. It's like 2 + 1 = 10. There's so much more energy and excitement and things going on and feelings and all that kind of stuff that I'm just sitting there going, oh man, I hope I don't mess this up as a parent. There's so many moments of confusion in there. And then even my family, my youngest brother, many of you know this, my youngest brother had an accident when he was in his late teens and became a quadriplegic. And the change that we went through in trying to figure out how do you live life now like that? And how do we support him? And how do we move forward with it? There were confusing moments in that. When my dad got diagnosed with his disease, the change that caused in our family and how we deal with that. And I know that's my list. Those are the changes that I've experienced. I know your list of changes is probably a lot longer and you're dealing with a lot more issues. But I know that as individuals, when we're dealing with these things one at a time, it's hard. But when they begin to snowball, when it becomes one challenge after the next, it can feel like it's overwhelming. that we are absolutely confused about what to do next. Now, the interesting thing about confusion is that we often go to the loudest voices for our answers, right? Like, think about something simple like this. Like, maybe you're buying a product on Amazon and you realize, hey, that's a great deal. And so the first thing you're going to do is you're going to research on whether or not this is a good product, right? You go to the reviews. And if you go to the reviews and the reviews say, I'm only going to give this one star, it's a junky product, you've escaped a catastrophe, right? The loudest voice said this is not a good product. The majority of the stars are one star. You don't buy the product. But the loudest answer isn't always true, right? Think about, I started playing this game with my kids this last week. The graphics are horrible on it, but it's called Among Us. And it's this online murder mystery game where you are an astronaut on this spaceship, and your job is to walk around and do tasks on this spaceship. And there is an imposter that's amongst you, and their job is to kill as many people as possible. And then periodically through the game will pause and you'll go into a chat and you get to talk with these other players and discuss who you think the murderer is and vote them off. But the funny thing about that is that the loudest person in that chat is not always the most truthful person. Sometimes they know, sometimes they have no idea, but they're just being loud. Sometimes they are the murderer and they're just trying to deceive everybody. And the loudest answers don't always give us the right answer. And that's why I think that these two principles are so important as we navigate confusing times in our life. These two principles transform us. They are challenging, but they are also so peace-giving. So I want to show you these two principles and talk about how they impact our life. So let's go to principle number one. This is principle number one. The answers are in the red letters. The answers are in the red letters. Well, what in the world does that mean? Well, if you've ever read a Bible, maybe you read one that was printed with some color text or you saw it online, you may notice that in some of the books of the Bible, there are some red letters. And those red letters represent Jesus speaking. Now, if you don't really understand the Bible, I'm going to give you a crash course on the Bible. The whole Bible is made up of really two sections. You have the first section, which is the Old Testament. You could maybe refer to that as the Hebrew Bible because it's referring to God's interaction with the Hebrews and the prophecies and the laws and their journey. And then the second half is the New Testament, or you would call the Christian Bible, which is really after Christ came, after Jesus came, it walks through his life and then the beginning of the church and really onto what we experience today, the basis of the church that we experience today. Well, there are these red letters that exist in there that give us a view into what Jesus actually was saying in the sermons that he gave, in the things that he said to the disciples, gives us a picture into who he was and what he said. In fact, I want to look at one of the things that he said to us. He said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." I am the way, the truth, and life. This is what's interesting about this. This is Jesus speaking about himself, and he says, I am the way. He is the way, the only way. That's it. He's it. Now, the great thing about that is that when he says, I'm the way, he's saying he is the only door to God, that you can see God and experience God in a lot. You can see him in a lot of different ways, but the only way to him is through Jesus. The great thing about that is that door is open to everyone. There is no prerequisite to knock on that door. You don't have to be a good person to knock on that door. You don't have to have a certain amount of religious education to knock on that door. Anyone can knock on that door. He's saying, I am the way. You want to find it? I'm it. And then he says, I am the truth, which is really the opposite of confusion. He's saying, I am the truth. In fact, in John chapter 7:17, he was talking to some Pharisees about whether or not he was God. And he challenged them. He basically said, test me, follow my commands, follow me, and that you will know that I am from God. He's saying he is the truth. And then he's saying I am the life. Physically, presently, he is bringing us a new beginning, a new growth, something new in following him, and spiritually into the future and forever. He is life-giving to us. And when I read those kind of statements, that kind of bold statement saying, I'm it, I'm the truth, I'm life, I wish that I could have been there. I wish I could have been there. You know, I think about my dad. I told you my dad has been diagnosed with a disease. It's called posterior cortical atrophy, which is a really rare form of Alzheimer's. And it messes up how he views and interacts with the world. And there's so often that when I'm talking to him or spending time with him, when I get a chance to spend time with him, I think about how I wish my kids and my nieces and nephews could have spent more time with him when he wasn't having to concentrate so hard on what actually was happening, when he could be playful and curious and interacting with him. I wish that they could experience that. I wish I would have written it down or recorded more of it so that they could get to participate in that. But I know that they still get to experience some of my dad, and I still look up to my dad and want to be my dad when I grow up. But I wish that there was a way that they could see and understand more of who he was. And I think that same way with Jesus. When I see this, I go, man, I want to know what he said. I want to hear what he said and how he responded to stuff. And he left that for us in the Gospels. He left that for us in Scripture to see what he said, to read it, to learn more about it, to understand it. But it's only on paper. And I know that when the disciples were realizing that Jesus was about to leave, they started to get nervous in the same way, that they were going, well, where are you going? How are we going to know what to do? And Jesus did this great thing. He knew that they were concerned. I'm sure he knows that we were concerned. And he offered us something. He said, if you love me, obey my commands, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate who will never leave you. He is the Holy Spirit who leads into all truth. The world cannot receive him because it isn't looking for him and doesn't recognize him. But you know him because he lives with you now and later will be in you. Jesus is saying, it's okay. It's okay. I've given you instruction, but I'm also leaving a Holy Spirit here who leads into all truth. That we have access to that. So that really, we've got that first principle, but the answers to all of our confusion are in the red letters. The second principle is this, that we read in community. And that, I mean that in two ways. I, one, mean that we read the red letters in community with the Holy Spirit, because Jesus left that for us, sent that for us so that we could begin to understand and get clarity into what Scripture was saying. And then really, that's just a matter of us asking the Holy Spirit in prayer for understanding and clarity. And then we read in community with other believers. Proverbs 27:17 says that as iron sharpens iron, so man one sharpens another, or so a friend sharpens another. When we read the red letters, when we read Jesus' words with other believers, it gives us the chance to process together, to think together, to work it out. There's sometimes when you think, how do I even recognize the Holy Spirit? Well, a community of believers is something that helps you do that. Somebody that's been down the path farther than you can help to guide you and give you insight into to Scripture, or even to what the Holy Spirit is saying. And that community, doing that in community is so, so important, because confusion only gets worse in isolation. Think about this. Have you ever had one of those nights where an idea came to you, where you went, oh my goodness, this thing is going to change the world. This is the best idea ever. And you scribble something down on your phone. You're like, I can't wait to tell people about this when they wake up. And then the next morning you get up and you're like, oh man, to your roommate or to your spouse, you go, I came up with this great idea. And you pull your phone out and you try to explain it, and you realize this doesn't really make any sense. When we only do these things in our own head, we lose the opportunity to talk about it and to say it out loud and to express it and ask questions and really wrestle with what those red letters are saying. So that first principle is so important, is that the answers are in the red letters, and that Jesus, those red letters are the words of Jesus, and that change comes from Jesus. And the answer to all of our questions is in Jesus. In fact, Pastor Gabe had an opportunity to interview a friend of ours, Bond, and he was talking to him about what was going on in the city of Portland and how we were dealing with racism. And Bond had this great thought that I want to share with you. So why don't you actually watch this?
I'm like, listen, let's get away from all this racism stuff and let's get to the cross. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about your heart. Because, okay, say you're racist. I'm saying it's across from you. Say you're a racist or whatever. Okay, let's say we cure your racism. You still probably have the sin of greed. You probably still have the sin of lust. You probably have a million other sins that aren't getting cured. So let's just focus on this one. So even if we solve the problem with just racism, we wouldn't be okay if we just left it there.
Yeah.
Because he's still struggling with different sins. But if we say, listen, you give a man the Holy Spirit, God gives a man the Holy Spirit, he does amazing work in the heart, and he takes the sin of lust, and he takes the sin of greed, and he takes the sin of pride, and he starts working on you, and he's chiseling you each and every day. So then you look more and more like Christ and less like the racist or whatever you were before, and then now you're transformed. But if we just say we just need to stop racism and we don't need to change the heart with the gospel, the man is still bound in other sins that are just as detrimental. So that's why I feel such a passion for the gospel, is because it's not just racism that's killing us. It's our sin plurals that's killing us.
That's so good, man. I love it.
Well, I love that. And in fact, if you want to see more of Bond's interview with Pastor Gabe, you can go actually, if you have subscribed to our YouTube channel or you've downloaded our app, you can go back to the series I Choose Joy and watch week 2. And there's a little more of that interview with him in case you missed it. But the question I think today is, if those principles are true, what can I do today? I want to tell you what you can do today to start thinking and implementing, thinking about and implementing those principles. The first, I want to talk to those of you who kind of are on the fence when I'm talking about this whole Jesus thing and the Holy Spirit, and you're not sure. You kind of are looking at me sideways and you're thinking, I don't know what I think about that. Before you decide what you think about Jesus, before you decide what you think about church, what you think about the Bible, what you think about Christians, I think you need to research Jesus and understand who he was. In fact, I want to challenge you to take a challenge today. So if you've got questions or you're not sure, you haven't made a decision about who Jesus is, I want you to text challenge to 503-905-9067. And that's going to enroll you in a several day challenge to read the Gospel of John. And what I want you to do is I want you to read that and think about the answer to the question, who is Jesus to you? That's all I want you to do. Not asking you to do anything special. I just want you to research it. I just want you to look into it. Don't make a decision without looking into it. And read that gospel, read story of Jesus, and make that decision for yourself. Now, if you are following Jesus and you're like, no, I know what I believe about Jesus. He's my forgiver. He's my leader. He's my savior. Then I want to encourage you to go back and read the red letters. Maybe go back and read them with somebody else. In fact, I would encourage you to text RED to 503-905-9067. And if you text RED, I'm going to send you a reading plan to the Synoptic Gospels. And what are the Synoptic Gospels? They are really all of the Gospels laid over each other chronologically. So when you go through this plan, you will read one passage. And if there's a reference to that same time or that same message or those same words of Jesus, you're going to read it in a different book from a different perspective. And it's going to take you all the way through the Gospels and Acts. And I would encourage you to read that together and to read those red letters, because when we are confused, when we're dealing with everything that we're dealing with, the answers to all of that confusion is in the red letters. It's in the red letters. So we're going to stop and we are going to sing some songs together. Now, if you are a Christ follower, these songs are a song of response to what Jesus has done in your life. And if you're not a Christ follower, I want you to listen to what these lyrics say as we describe who Jesus is. And one of the things I'm most excited about is that we're going to see some baptisms that have happened over this last week that are people who have said, I believe in Jesus. I want to identify with him. I want my life to be changed. And these are people who have been transformed by Jesus, just like Bond said, just like Scripture says, that Jesus transforms us. So would you sing a few of these songs as we ask the West Side Band to lead us together?
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Empty praise and treasures that fade, never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. No. And I'm not ashamed to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all. You still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley.
Emily, it's so great to have you here with us today, really celebrating and demonstrating your faith out loud in a public way, just like Christians have for thousands of years. Jesus commanded us to be baptized, and this is your way of showing that you belong to Jesus, that you are his bride in that sense, and that he is your husband in many ways. So today we're excited to help you take this step. I want to ask you a question.
Sure.
Have you accepted Jesus as your personal Lord?
Yes.
Okay. Well, based on your belief in Jesus and your willingness to follow him, we're baptizing you today in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Buried in the likeness of his death. Raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Awesome. Yeah. So, Kristen, have you accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes, I have.
All right. Well, based on your belief in Jesus and your willingness to follow him, Susie's going to baptize you as her sister in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Okay.
Yeah. Miguel, have you accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior?
I have.
Yes. Okay. Well, based on your faith in him and your willingness to follow him, Dion's going to baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. He's going to grab onto his arm there.
There you go.
So the Bible says that when we're baptized, we're buried in the likeness of his death. Look at that. I want to ask you the question, have you accepted Jesus as your own personal Lord and Savior?
Yes, I have.
All right. Well, based on your declaration of faith in him and your willingness to follow him, Neil is going to baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Buried in the likeness of his death. Raised in the likeness of his death.
Baptism is just like, it's just a declaration of her faith in Jesus, and she's one of the most faithful women I've ever known. She is so passionate about God and about just truth and just morality, and I just admire her so stinking much. It's ridiculous.
Stacy, have you been, have you accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior?
I have.
Okay. Well, then based on your own statement of faith and your obedience to Jesus' command, Melissa's going to baptize you as her sister in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Yeah!
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us for Church Online today. If you are not already following Westside on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, take a second to do that today to keep up with our events and just get some encouragement throughout the week as well. You are invited back next week for the finale of our series, Where is Jesus in All This Mess?, where Pastor Gabe will be talking about where is Jesus in the waiting. We will also be celebrating communion, so go to the store, get some crackers, get some juice, and be ready for that special moment. If you need a boost of encouragement and hope, then come on back next week and bring a friend as well. We can all benefit from having some more Jesus in our life, right? All right, I will see y'all next week. It's going to be a great week for all of us simply because Jesus loves us beyond all measure. So trust and believe in that. I'll see y'all next week. God bless you.
Good morning, Westside students. Coming to you from our Westside Students Cafe. Hey, it's lesson time. So go to westsidecommunitychurch.com/students for today's lesson. Go check it out.
Hi, my name is Stacy Allen, and I am the Kids Ministry Director here at Westside Community Church. There's four things I want to tell you about today. The first one is, if you visit our kids ministry website, you will find on-demand content for you to use with your family at home whenever you choose. There's content for preschool children, content through for kindergarten through third grade, and then there's also preteen content for fourth and fifth graders, or we call them Club 45. This is updated weekly, so each week there's a new lesson for you to do at home with your children. Secondly, if you haven't already done so, I'd encourage you to download the Parent Q app. This app is another wonderful tool for you to use to talk about faith with your child at home. It has activities and ideas and things that are based on God's big story and are written directly for each developmental stage in a child's life. So no matter where your child is, however old they are, what stage of life they're in, there will be content there for you to use to talk with them about Jesus. Those of you that will be doing distance learning at home might be interested in this third thing. You have access to a free subscription to Right Now Media through our Westside Community Church website. Right Now Media has a variety of videos and Bible studies, and there's a whole section directed just towards children. So for those of you that are looking to add some Bible stories or Bible study to your curriculum for the fall, you can go there and see. They've got just a lot of different activities and videos that you can choose. And there's a lot of good stuff for adults on that too. And then lastly, if you haven't already done so, please join our Kids Ministry Facebook group. It's Westside Community Church Kids, and there we're posting information about each week's lesson, pictures of activities that are going on, information about events that we'll be holding, and we'll just have some messages from volunteers, and it'll be another way to just stay connected with all of us there in Kids Ministry. So I hope you have a good week, and we'll see you soon. Bye.